Hello and welcome to From the Helm. I'm Grady Wulff, Market Analyst with Bell Direct, and today I'm thrilled to be interviewing the Executive Chairman of Clarity Pharmaceuticals, Alan Taylor. Clarity Pharmaceuticals ticker code is CU6. Clarity has risen to the top of the ASX and healthcare sector in 2024 with a 90% rally year to date. For those who don't know, Clarity Pharmaceuticals specialises in the development of targeted copper theranostics for imaging and treatment of different cancers. Radiopharmaceuticals are a well-established field of medicine, and in recent years, it has experienced significant expansion thanks to the development of new technology. In particular, the identification of certain cancer biomarkers and new science to target those biomarkers with either small molecules or monoclonal antibodies attached to a rapidly decaying isotope has facilitated. The company has an extensive program of clinical development for imaging and cancer therapy with a series of important data readouts over the next few years. CU6 has an extensive register of patents, including 24 patent families covering its intellectual property. Today, we are thrilled to be joined by the Clarity Pharmaceuticals Executive Chairman, Alan Taylor. Alan, thank you for your time today.
Thank you.
For any of our investors who may not be familiar with the Clarity Pharmaceuticals story, can you tell us a bit about the company and what you're up to at the moment?
I can, yes. So this area of radiopharmaceuticals is somewhat new and novel in the world, right? So, but if you think about cancer, cancer is a nasty disease that it's really hard to kill, right? We've used in the past surgery, chemotherapy, you're trying to poison the cancer itself, and then you're using external beam radiation. Radiation from outside of the body goes through inside of the body and zaps the tumors,
yeah,
hopefully to kill them, right? But now, in this modern age, we've got to understand cancers a little bit better. Mm-hmm. So now we've able to develop these products that specifically target the cancer, and there's a little bit of radiation on that targeting product that binds to the cancer and kills the cancer. So now instead of external beam just shooting one cancer or another cancer, we can find many cancers in the body,
wow,
and then kill them. It's really cool.
It's definitely the way forward in 2024. Now you have 7 clinical trials underway. Which one do you think is the most promising in the market environment right now?
So if we focus on a product, BIS-PSMA is a phenomenal product, and it's we've got clinical trials running in diagnostics, moving to phase 3 now, so to get that product to market in the next couple of years to better diagnose cancers. But the fun bit is getting rid of cancers, right?
Yeah.
So that therapy trial is called Secure, and that is an incredible trial. We've already had some amazing responses, including a complete response in the patient. The first patient we dosed at 2 doses at a therapeutic level.
Wow.
It was phenomenal.
So speaking of the Secure trial, what cancers are you targeting and what is the results you've seen so far? As you said, it was pretty good for one patient. How many patients have been dosed?
So there's many now. So we started off at a very low dose at what's termed 4 gigabecquerels, mm-hmm, right? Half the dose of what the incumbent product is treating at. And we found a third of the patients responded very well to that, including one of those patients now living however many, many months, even years now, out, and with a PSA level down at about 1 and controlled, mm-hmm, their prostate cancer. So yep, this is all in prostate cancer.
Now, right, with that patient, it's a 2 doses drugs of the 8 gigabecquerels dose, being 1 interim dose. Can you please explain what the reading is and why it's such a significant milestone? So 8 compared to 4.
Yeah, so we went up because the safety profile was excellent,
yeah,
and remains excellent. So we went up to 8 gigabecquerels, right? And so we treated 3 patients in that 8 gigabecquerel cohort, and mm-hmm, all of them responded very well.
Yeah.
Right? One of them, their PSA fell 80% plus, and the other 2 90% plus.
Wow.
So at one of the locations, it's one of the clinicians said, this is such a phenomenal response in a patient that failed 5 to 7 lines of therapy, mm-hmm, including all the, like all the latest androgen receptor antagonists,
wow,
the PARP inhibitors, many lines of chemotherapy, and had no hope.
Yeah.
So we dosed at 8 gigabecquerels. Their PSA dropped 90-odd percent.
Wow.
Right, in one dose. So the clinician said, let's dose again. So we dosed again, mm-hmm, and what happened was we had undetectable PSA.
Wow.
Right? A phenomenal outcome,
yeah,
for a man with prostate cancer.
Yeah.
Had undetectable disease using imaging with a product, BIS-PSMA,
mm-hmm,
but then also had undetectable disease on a measure that we think called the RESIST protocol,
wow,
using other methods of imaging, and the tumors were gone.
That
and they've been gone now for many months. PSA has been undetectable now for 10 plus months, and this patient is living without their
prostate
cancer.
Effectively cancer-free.
Exactly.
That is phenomenal, especially given we've known so much about cancer for so long, but there's been no specific treatment that hasn't kind of killed every other healthy cell in the body, right?
That's all right.
So talking about ASX listed companies, Telix Pharmaceutical, a lot of our investors know about Telix in the same cancer space. Can you tell us how Clarity differentiates in technologies, processes, commercialization phase progress, a lot of different areas to Telix for those who don't know?
Yeah, so it's great. We've got in Australia, because radiopharmaceuticals isn't a big area globally.
It's right?
So it's great. Yeah, it's very
yeah,
new.
Yeah.
Right? So it's great. We've got two good companies here with Telix commercializing, particularly a diagnostic, first to market, or not first to market, but in a market where we're identifying lesions very early in prostate cancer.
Yeah.
It's terrific. And but where we differentiate, we're an Aussie born and bred company,
yeah.
Right? We're from the bench top of Australian science, mm-hmm. Specifically out of the University of Melbourne.
Wow.
And we develop these products and an ability to hold copper specifically. So we're specifically involved with two isotopes of copper, copper-64 for imaging and copper-67 mm-hmm. for therapy. And all of our products are related to that underlying technology.
Yeah.
Telix is taking the approach of they want to acquire and build and get access to
big pharma.
They're in sort of a I don't know how many isotopes, 10 maybe. Yeah. So they've taken a different approach to us. So that's where we completely differentiate. We have absolute confidence in our pipeline. We're not looking to acquire other companies. Mm-hmm. We're looking to develop the products that we have in house. And what we did, which is different to a lot of companies around the world in our space. We actually looked at what was in the market. So these PSMA agents, we looked at, you know, how they were structured, and we made one like that. And ours was as equally as bad as theirs. So what we did was go back to the benchtop,
yeah.
And we created a new molecule,
mm-hmm.
one with two targets on it.
Yeah.
And that did a few things for us. It increased the uptake of our product in the cancers,
mm-hmm.
which you want to do, right?
Yeah.
You're trying to get as much product in the cancers as possible.
Yeah.
So it increased about 2 to 3 times as much.
Mm-hmm.
And it stays there over time. So
wow.
Suddenly we have a product, which is a fantastic therapy because you have this massive amount of radiation in the tumors themselves mm-hmm. over time and killing the cancer. And that's why we're seeing such good responses in our therapy. But also diagnostically, you want to see a lot more product there to overcome a lot of the issues with these PSMA agents, mm-hmm. particularly around what's termed sensitivity.
Yeah.
Right? So that means just because it's not lighting up on a PET camera, it doesn't mean it's not cancer,
yeah.
right? So we've had these fantastic results diagnostically, a lot more product in the lesions, and then we can measure at later time points, 24 hours or 48 hours, where we pick up a lot more lesions.
Yeah.
It's
now,
exciting.
Speaking of you're developing diagnostic and therapeutic treatments for these cancers, what's the differentiation in revenue bringing in for the company, and what does this mean for revenue when you get to commercialization phase? And also from a risk perspective, what's the risk involved?
Great question. And companies should often look at this, right? You're looking at assets that you're investing in and you want to know the risk reward,
mm-hmm.
right? Therapy is high risk, high reward.
Yeah.
The process is longer. But the reward is so much more significant. And when you look at big pharma companies, they're all competing against each other looking to find new therapies, right?
Yeah.
So the upside is so much more significant on therapies, and you know, it's such a great pursuit. Trying to better treat people with cancer is a much better pursuit, we feel.
Yeah.
But diagnostics, earlier to market,
mm-hmm.
lower risk,
yeah.
lower reward, but at least then you're generating revenues for your company. So we're looking to commercialize our first diagnostic in the next couple of years after we finish the phase 3 clinical trials. And the revenues from these PSMA agents now are well into the billions of US dollars just in the US alone.
That's incredible.
So when we say low reward, it's actually probably a little more than what you'd usually expect from a diagnostic. Given how exciting this new field is, lots of people want to know if they've got prostate cancer, they want to know where it is, and they want to treat it as early as possible, right, to optimize their outcomes. And these new agents are phenomenal in doing that.
Absolutely. Now, you did mention about the progress in the diagnostic treatment to market. How close is a therapeutic treatment to market in submission for regulatory approval?
Yeah, so the therapy is going to take longer. Yeah. We've chosen an interesting road. We chose to go back to the drawing board with a product that we think is now the best PSMA agent ever invented. Mm-hmm. Right? We've actually gone the task of doing a dose optimization, which takes a little longer,
yep.
right? Because the incumbent product, Pluvicto, was never dose optimized, mm-hmm. right? So now, and we spoke about the 8 gigabecquerel patient group.
Yeah, yeah.
Now we're at 12 gigabecquerels.
Wow.
Right? And we're getting phenomenal responses, even in patients that have failed every line of therapy.
Wow.
Right? And we're not seeing any safety concerns.
Mm-hmm.
So now we're at multi-dosing at 12 gigabecquerels mm-hmm. at that dose escalation.
Wow.
And then we're going to do an expanded cohort. We'll get all of that done. All the dosing planned to be done this year,
mm-hmm.
right? If not spilling into the start of next year, then there's a follow-up period, then we start a phase 3 clinical trial.
And will you target the US and Australia for regulatory submission? Obviously, the FDA is the hardest one to get, but what's the global rollout process?
So the US is the center of the world when it yeah. comes to this,
yeah.
right? And you can't run commercial organizations like ours without focusing on that. Investors want to make a return on their money,
yeah.
and that is the biggest market and the greatest reimbursement and greatest opportunity. And the process is well structured, and we've got a great relationship with the FDA, and
mm-hmm.
I think we've got 5 INDs over 6 products now,
wow.
right? So, and are working through clinical trials. That'll be the initial focus, but we have close relationships here, particularly in our, you know, great little town of Sydney.
Yeah.
We're very close to St. Vincent's Hospital and, cool. and Professor Louise Emmett there. So she'll be part of our clinical trials
mm-hmm.
And particularly the SECURE trial. And we'll be doing a little bit more. I did my PhD at the Garvin Institute in that precinct, and it's a really good site. She's a phenomenal key opinion leader.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll continue to do our clinical trials here so that when registration is, we achieve registration with the FDA.
Yeah.
We can follow that up with in Australia.
Absolutely. Now, there's been a massive amount of corporate activity in the radiopharmaceuticals industry, and given it's so new, there's a lot of interest in it from Big Pharma. We've seen the likes of Fusion Pharmaceuticals, Raise Bio, Point Biopharma, and more recently, Mariana Oncology, acquired by large global companies. Now, that's a big list of names. Why is it so attractive for the Big Pharmas to acquire these companies in the space?
It's a fascinating time.
Yeah.
Right. So those transactions have happened in the last 6 months.
Wow.
and for big numbers. Like Raise, that's had a couple of products in development, was bought for $4.1 billion.
Wow.
AstraZeneca acquired Fusion weeks ago for $2.4 billion.
Wow.
Right. And they were only just really at a phase one.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, Mariana, the last one, the one you mentioned there, is preclinical.
Wow.
And was acquired,
so not even doing clinical trials right now.
No, and was acquired for $1.75 billion US with $1 billion upfront.
Wow.
It's incredible, right? So,
yeah.
And this is because this area of radiopharm is the new area, is the new opportunities to, the great opportunities to get to first-line therapies.
Yeah.
Great efficacy that we're seeing with excellent safety profiles, mm-hmm. right? So, but a lot of those companies are so early in their development,
yeah.
so they still have to work themselves out as companies. We now find ourselves as one of the later stage companies globally,
mm-hmm.
doing the proper, as I said, develop new products, getting phenomenal therapy outcomes, as well
yeah.
as diagnostic. And now the play is open. It's,
mm.
It's a global market for intellectual property. There's a lot of pharma companies that are running into what we call patent cliffs. A lot of products coming off patents in about 2028 with
okay.
massive reductions in revenues.
Mm-hmm.
So then they're looking for other ways to actually overcome that.
Yeah.
And radiopharm is now front and center.
Yep.
It's just that there's not many companies out there.
So with 24 patent families under your belt, does that put an acquisition target on your back?
Well, it comes with the territory, doesn't
it? Does,
if
yeah.
you're generating fantastic, and this has always been our position, translate great Australian science from the mm-hmm. benchtop to the global market. Strong intellectual property. This is a little bit of an old-fashioned way, I guess, but a strong intellectual property, which you just noted,
yeah.
and then incredible data.
Yeah,
that's what clinical development companies need to do, and that is our primary focus.
Yeah.
Now these companies, even with those acquisitions, they've really just put their toe in the water.
Yeah,
and now they don't actually have pipelines. They don't have pipeline opportunities. So there's a lot of them that want to be the number one in radiopharm. We'll see how that market develops.
Australia is very well known for its healthcare industry, and this is definitely putting us on the map. So final question today, why should any of our investors at Bell Direct and Bell Potter consider investing in Clarity Pharmaceuticals right now?
Look, investing is a personal decision, right? From my perspective, and I've been involved in this company now since the beginning, mm-hmm. and spent the last 11 years growing this company with our team, right? We have $150 million in the bank after a nice capital raising, which yep. Bell's assisted with us on about a month ago. And that puts us in a very strong position over the next couple of years to continue to drive out this therapy data, supported then by diagnostic products getting to market, right? In a market that you noted, big pharma. Big pharma isn't one company.
No.
It's a bunch of companies trying to compete with each other.
Yeah.
So it's a fascinating global market. Radiopharm is really on a precipice of, you know, dominating now oncology.
Yeah.
But we're still at the start.
Yeah, it could be the next big thing.
I think it is.
Alan Taylor, thank you so much for your time today. We really appreciate it and really love talking to all of our companies from the helm. My name is Grady Wulff, Market Analyst with Bell Direct, and I hope you enjoyed that episode.